and the Curves tool allows you to adjust brightness and contrast. The Curves tool in PixInsight does allow you to adjust brightness and contrast, but you can also adjust saturation based on how saturated the pixel was to start with. So what you can do is you can have a curve that says increase the saturation on the very unsaturated pixels, but leave the saturated pixels the way they are. So you can do that. You can brighten or dim or change the contrast of each color channel separately, the RGB channels. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the LAB color space. That's luminance and the A and B color channels, chrominance channels. You can adjust them individually. And the alpha channel is important for ping files. Ping files can be can have a transparent background. And that's what the alpha channel is for. It's for adjusting the transparency of the background. So I tend to use curves at this stage in a simple workflow just for brightness and contrast and saturation. You don't really need to worry too much about the other ones. In the advanced workflow tomorrow, we are going to deal with the LAB channels a little bit and maybe even with the individual color channels. Pardon me? Yeah, some people prefer using the A and B channels. Well-kept secret, PixInsight switches your image into LAB before it does the change and then switches it back. So you're using LAB whether you mean to or not. Okay, let's talk a little bit about what we're trying to do when we adjust brightness and contrast. So first of all, we want to darken the background, but we don't want to make it too dark. The sky isn't black. And if you go to black, you've clipped some of your data. Often you'll find, like if you look at the galaxies M81 and M82, there's a lot of really faint nebulosity, or I guess it's galactic cirrus, the integrated flux nebula around that, which if you try for a black background, you're going to lose all that. You also want to make it bright, but not too bright. First of all, it'll look garish and unnatural. But second of all, it creates problems with blowout of star cores, and stars get way too big, and just not a nice view. You want all levels of brightness to be visible and distinct. And by the way, that is easier with black and white images than it is with color images. Your eye has much more, many more shades of gray than it can see than shades of color. And you want the transitions between dark and bright areas to look natural as opposed to sharp. So that's the brightness and contrast goals. For saturation goals, for me, is I like the colors to look natural. And I'm a natural color guy. Some people ask me, are the colors in your pictures natural? I don't know, because I've never seen it with my eye. I've only seen it on the screen. But I try not to impose my own judgment on it. I try to let PixSight tell me what average white is and what average black is. And at least that way, I'm being objective about it as opposed to being too subjective. Not that there's anything wrong with being subjective, just a different kind of brownie, right? Do it any way you want. You want color noise not to be obvious. Color tends to, you get speckling in color. And using a luminance channel can really help with that, especially if you use a synthetic luminance that's based on the color. And again, we'll talk about that tomorrow. And we want the background areas to look neutral. That can be particularly challenging when you're doing a close-up shot of something like M42, where it's really hard to find a background area. But if that's the case, use a bigger image and then crop it at the end. You know, there's always another way to skin that cat. So that's what we want to get with curves. And here's how I did it in this case. So I put a very gentle contrast enhancing curve. So I made the darks a little bit darker. Remember, all the data is down here, right near the black end of the histogram. I kept the midtones about where they were for brightness these are the mid-tones here. And I made the fairly bright areas a little bit brighter, so I enhanced the brightness here. So that boosts, that's going to boost the contrast for me. Then I boosted the color, and I only used 2 points on my color curve. I think you'll see them on the next slide. But the goal was to increase the less saturated areas more and not to increase the saturation in the areas that already had a lot of saturation. So when we apply that, here's what we get. Boom. So again, let's look before and after. Quite nice, eh? So you only need a few image processing steps to get really nice images. And you know, one of the things I want to say about PixInsight, a lot of newcomers to PixInsight over the years have told me that there's just not that much documentation available. It's hard to find how to do things. That's not true anymore. I'm going to give you some links to a lot of resources in a moment. It's important to get rid of the big problems before you really start stretching the data. Otherwise, you're going to be enhancing the bad stuff. So you got to get the gradients out of there, get your color balanced, and get rid of that salt and pepper noise before you stretch. After you stretch, you can do all kinds of things. So you can do more noise reduction and stretching. You can bring out fine details. You can do some sharpening. The biggest thing you have to do with PixInsight or Photoshop or anything else is after you bake that cake a few times, stop using the book and see what happens when you change the mix of the ingredients. You have to experiment. Everybody's going to have a different setup. And you know, the other thing I didn't talk about, which I probably should have said right at the opening, is it's very, very important to use a calibrated monitor. So the screen you look at should be properly calibrated, preferably with a hardware calibrator. I use a Spider 5 calibration tool, but there's a lot of different ways to skin that cat too. But it's important that the picture on my screen looks the same as it does on your screen and looks the same as it does in a print. That's a color calibrated workflow, so make sure you calibrate your monitors. So experiment and see what happens. Now, what else is there in PixInsight? What else could we have talked about today? Well, not much, because I only have 15 minutes left and I want to leave plenty of time for questions. But masks are really important. You probably know about masks if you use Photoshop. These are black and white files that protect certain parts of the image from what you're about to do and allow the process to happen where you want it to happen. Deconvolution. A lot of people think deconvolution is sharpening. They're very, very different. Deconvolution is a mathematical tool that separates a signal from a blurring function, basically. Something that's called convolution, when you mix two things together. You know how when you put milk in coffee, it's hard to get the milk out, right? Okay. In astronomy, you can get the milk out with deconvolution. You can separate those two ingredients and back out the atmospheric blurring function. HDR stands for high dynamic range. If you have an iPhone or a Samsung phone, it has an HDR mode in it. Great for taking pictures of sunsets and things like that, where you have really bright areas and really dark areas. What it does is it treats them differently. It makes the very bright areas a little darker, and it makes the very dark areas a little brighter so that you can see everything. So that is a very helpful tool, especially if you, a good example of this astronomically is if you want to take a picture of the Orion Nebula. The trapezium is right in the middle of the brightest area. If you shorten your exposure so that you can see the trapezium, you won't get any of the beautiful wings and outer detail. If you make your exposures long to get the outer detail, you can't see the trapezium anymore. It's just a blown out patch of sky. use short and long exposures together and combine them to give you an image that shows both. Noise reduction. So noise reduction is about subduing noise without losing detail. We're all after detail, but you gotta get the noise out. Sharpening is sort of the converse of noise reduction. So sharpening detail, but not at the expense of increasing the noise in your image. That wouldn't look very nice either. Sometimes you get stars that are either too prominent in your image, or maybe they're a little bit of oblong, and those eggy stars can be from all kinds of things. It could be from bad tracking, poor alignment, bad optics. If it's not too bad, you can fix it with morphological transformation. Morphology is a word that means shape. So morphological transformation is a shape-changing tool. And you use that with a mask that protects everything except your stars. If you shoot hydrogen alpha or oxygen 3 data or sulfur data with a narrow band filter, but you're like me and you like natural colors too, you can combine those two types of data to reveal a lot more detail than you would get just with RGB data. So there's tools for combining that stuff to really make nebulas pop, or to show the nebulas in other galaxies that might not be so obvious. You can make a synthetic luminance, a synthetic brightness channel, from whatever data you have available. And again, we're gonna talk about that tomorrow. We talked about one multi-scale method, which was the linear noise reduction, but there's other multi-scale methods that you can use too, that target target structures based on their size. So you can target just the very small structures, sharpen them, and maybe soften the very big structures, and then put it all back together again. Pixel math. If you like math, or if you like this image and you like that image, you can use pixel math to combine them. Very, very useful for making masks. So sometimes what I'll do is I'll take my luminance or synthetic luminance, I'll make a star mask using the star mask command, and then I'll use pixel math to subtract the star mask from my luminance image. That becomes a new mask that protects the stars and the background, and my next operation will only affect the galaxy or nebula, but the stars won't be messed up. And painting. There are painting tools, just like in Photoshop. Well, not just like in Photoshop. There's a philosophical difference, which I'll talk about in a sec, but allows you to fix any artifacts that are left over, make your masks more effective, and sometimes annotate your images, so put writing on them or point to things with arrows. During the advanced workshop, we're going to be working on a full data set, but these are the three tools, or the three techniques that I really want to highlight in tomorrow's workshop. Deconvolution is a tool that people really struggle with. I struggled with it for years, to the point that maybe even the last time I came here 2 years ago, I said, I don't bother with it because it just messes things up. Now I use it in virtually every image because I figured it out, and I'm going to share that with you tomorrow. There are a lot of resources. I'm very, very proud of this book. Some of you might know Warren Keller. He's spoken here before. He was hanging around here last night. Warren Keller is the author of Inside PixInsight, which was published by Springer Press. I was the technical reviewer and editor for that book. And Warren and I have taught courses together. If you write to Warren, contact him via ip4ap.com. That's Image Processing for Astrophotography. ip4ap.com. Write him and tell him that you heard Ron speak at the Winter Star Party, and he will give you a discount on the book and send you a signed copy. It is, I know I'm biased, you know, I helped produce the book, but it's a great tool. I still refer to it from time to time when I'm struggling with something. Did I miss a step? It covers everything, everything that you would need to use, even in a very complex workflow. If you'd rather not pay for a book or for tutorials, there's really good free resources on the web. But by the way, you paid thousands of dollars for your telescope, thousands of dollars for your mount, not to mention your camera, not to mention your software. Buy the book. I'm telling you, you know. Harry's Astroshed, great free tutorials, especially for beginners. Really good for beginners. You can see him working the magic on the screen and follow along. There's paid tutorials at ipforap.com, so that's a subscription service. I think it's like $2 or $3 a month, and you get all the new tutorials as well as all the old ones. The PixInsight forum, if you're a book learner, that's a very effective place to find solutions that people have found to problems, or see if somebody had the same problem that you had and what they did about it. And people like me contribute to that forum regularly. I have a website which I mentioned to you, astrodocs.ca. My PixInsight workflow is documented. There's a copy of my Sky and Telescope article from last summer at the website. And if you're coming to the workshop tomorrow, I have an article coming out, I think in the May, it could be May or June, Sky and Telescope on deconvolution. So that might help you as well. If you click on the articles tab at my website, you'll find all kinds of other stuff about my workflow as well. And every image I post on my website has complete processing details, exactly what I did. Most of the settings, I don't give 100% of settings. I'm trying to improve that, but it's a lot of work. But if I haven't specified a setting, it means I probably use the default. And I also do private and group tutoring over the internet. So if that's something that interests you, that's great. But please, don't spend all that money on your equipment and then not be able to make the most of your data. You don't want to leave good data on the table. The good news is, it's good news and bad news. The bad news is, I've had terrible weather for the last several months. But I have really good data going back to 2012, before I knew how to use PixInsight very well. And I'm reprocessing a lot of my data and getting better results because I've learned more. So the point is, as long as you have good data, it doesn't matter if you can't get a perfect result now. Keep working on it, and one day you're going to say, I got to go back to that image of the Crab Nebula, because now I know what to do with it. So do that. Okay, that's the end of the formal part of the talk, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have. Or that you might not have. Yes?
I have PixInsight on my desktop at home, but I don't have it on my laptop. Is there a way to get it tonight so that I could attend the tutorial?
Yeah, you can download it from PixInsight distribution site. As long as you know your login credentials, you can get it. Yes?
What's the average time that you would spend on taking an image? Do you take a lot of short images and stack them, or longer ones?
It depends on the sky conditions. When I have a lot of moonlight or I'm shooting in the south where my sky is at its worst, I tend to take more short exposures. When I'm shooting in a darker sky, I tend to take longer exposures. There are mathematical tools for figuring out what the optimal exposure length is. One thing you can do is go to the Starizona website. They have an exposure length calculator. So you take a 5-minute image or whatever, put in your details of your camera, and a couple of measurements, and it will tell you what the optimum subframe length is for that circumstance. And the average time I use total depends on two things. One, it depends on the focal ratio of my telescope, and two, it depends on the sensitivity of my camera. So you need to experiment. With very, very few exceptions, I've found that you can't shoot too long, but also with very, very few exceptions, you can get great results from short exposures. So here's a bit of a trade-off that you might consider. So I have a Paramount MX. I'm able to shoot unguided for 5 minutes, but not for 10. Okay. If I shoot unguided for 5 minutes with dithering, I don't have to reacquire the guide star that takes a minute or so between exposures. And probably over the course of the night, I can get an extra five-minute frames, which might allow me to use a different rejection method to get a cleaner result. On the other hand, if I've got a really dark sky and I want those long exposures, I'll take fewer frames, longer exposures, and I'm not worried about the lost time during dithering because I'm doing less subframes. So it's always a trade-off, you know? But there's no wrong way to do it. It's really hard to get too long. You know, aim for what you can consistently get a good frame on. One thing I would advise against, unless you're shooting narrowband data, I tend never to go longer than about 20 minutes, because in my sky, if I go 30 minutes, I can pretty much guarantee an airplane or a satellite. And then I lose 20 minutes, or I have to deal with that, at least, in processing. Whereas if I go 5 minutes, I might get to keep 15 minutes and throw one away. So it's an experiment. It depends on your conditions. Other questions? Yes? Where am I from? Guelph, Ontario. Sounds like Elf.
Okay.
But it's about an hour and change west of Toronto. And my skies are about a Bortle class 4 on a good day, 5 on a bad day. Yes?
Do you ever use a histogram of an image to see how long, whether you exposed it long enough?
No, I never use the histogram to tell me if I've exposed it long enough, because all the data is near the black end of the histogram. What the histogram tells me sometimes is that I have an observatory at my house, and often I control it from inside my house where I'm watching TV with my wife. Otherwise, she'd be calling me her first husband. She's not yet. But in that situation, I can always see the histogram. If I see the histogram move away from the black, I know clouds have come in, because everything's turned gray instead of black. That's how I use it. Yes, anything else?
What image scale do you shoot at?
Pardon me?
Image scale
you use. Image scale. Okay, so image scale is a really interesting question. I aim for 1 arc second per pixel in my skies, and that's based on a theorem called the Nyquist theorem. It's a mathematical theorem that has to do with sampling and signal strength and signal significance as well. But in a nutshell, without getting too mathematical, the Nyquist theorem tells you that you want to have an image scale that's about 1/3 of what you can resolve. So my seeing where I live is typically around 3 arc seconds per pixel. So I aim for 1 arc second per pixel. But I really don't stew if I'm at 3 or 4 arc seconds per pixel. I really don't worry about it if I'm at 1/2 or 1/4 of an arc second per pixel. I try to get 1. So now I'm shooting with a Takahashi FSQ-106, and the camera that I'm using with the focal reducer, it gives me an image scale of about 3.2 arc seconds per pixel. So that's 3 times my ideal. My smallest stars can be a little blocky. That's because the starlight is falling on 1 pixel or less. That's the problem with undersampling. PixInsight has a solution for that. It's called drizzle integration. It was actually developed by NASA. And it rounds out those stars beautifully. So again, don't sweat the small stuff. Right? A lot of people shoot at 10 arc seconds per pixel. If you're using a DSLR taking pictures of the Milky Way, you might be at 6, 8, 10 arc seconds per pixel. It depends what you're trying to reveal. So one of the things that annoys me a little bit is pixel peeping. Right? When I send out an image, I want you to look at the image. I don't want you to look at 1 pixel in the image or 10 pixels in the image and tell me what that's like. I'm interested in making an artistic impression on you with the whole picture. So don't sweat it too much, image scale. The other thing about image scale to think about is that a large image scale, say 3 to 10 arc seconds per pixel, is much more forgiving of all kinds of errors. When you get down to 1 arc second per pixel, now a little bit of wobble in your mount, a little bit of misalignment, that starts to show. Whereas at higher image scales, you're not going to see that. So again, it's all about what it is that you're trying to display and how good your equipment is. Yes?
I just spoke about pretty versus accurate. I'm assuming that's your photo.
Yes. Every photo you saw was mine.
Okay. So what's pretty and what's accurate?
None of it is accurate, and all of it's pretty. I'll tell you what's accurate is the positions of the stars and all the objects. I haven't moved them around. But beyond that, everything else is how I thought it looked nice. Selective enhancement of the data. So some people have looked at this and they've said, I hate these spikes. Can you get those out of there with a spot? Am I done? So, I think I just got the hook. Some people don't like those spikes. Other people put fishing line across their refractors to get the spikes. I tend not to pay too much attention to what other people like. They can produce their own pictures. I'm showing you what I like. And if you like it, that's great. And if you have a constructive criticism, I always consider every comment. And often I will make a new version of the image that addresses that comment, and then I'll either change what I've posted, and often give credit to whoever told me about it, or I say, no, you know what? I was right the first time. I liked it. Some people say to me about this image, well, I can see the trapezium, but you lost all the color in here. Yeah, whatever. I'm over it. I was over it already. So really, there's nothing here that I could tell you is accurate except for the position of the objects. Not even the relative brightness of the objects is accurate. Like, there is no way that this bright area of the nebula is as bright as some of these bright stars. It just isn't, or you'd see it, and you don't. This is how I thought the data looked nicely presented. So, anything else? Thank you so much for having me. I got to tell you, it's wonderful to be here, and I have rarely hung out with such a fun group of people, so thank you.